Good. Okay, we were discussing systems of linear equations. First, we have seen arbitrary systems of linear equations. By arbitrary, I mean the right-hand side of each equation may or may not be zero. And then the way that we solve such questions is we consider the coefficient matrix, put a slash, and then put the matrix B, form the augmented matrix A, B, and then put it into row reduced echelon form or echelon form. At some point when we see that it is easy enough, it is simple enough, then we start looking at the final equations, because by applying the elementary row operations, what you are looking at is an equivalent system of equations. So the solution set will not change. And then if there, so you may say that there are no solutions if your system is inconsistent, there might be a unique solution, which is actually equivalent to saying that your matrix A is invertible. Once you form that augmented matrix, then you can easily see that the linear system of equations is nothing but solving a matrix multiplication. A, X is equal to B. X being a column matrix representing variables, unknowns. B is the right-hand side of each equation. There might be a single solution, no solutions, or infinitely many solutions. And then we have seen, some of us have seen, homogeneous system of equations where the right-hand side is all zeros. If that is the case, then there is always at least one solution. You can assign zero to each of your unknowns, it will produce a solution. So that is called the trivial solution. So there will be either a trivial, there will be either a unique trivial solution, or there will be infinitely many solutions. Infinitely many solutions will occur. Suppose you start with n unknowns and n variables. So you don't need to form augmented matrix. You can just work with your coefficient matrix and equations and unknowns. You apply elementary row operations. If you have a row of zeros, then immediately you will understand that there are n unknowns, but less than n equations. So there will be a free variable. The number of zero rows tells you how many free variables you need to introduce to solve such equations. So once you have free variables, you can find fundamental solutions. If you have two free variables, then you, by assigning one to one of them, zero to the other, you will get one fundamental solution, and then zero to the first one, one to the second free variable will produce another fundamental solution. Those fundamental solutions are actually basis for the solution space of a system of homogeneous equations. We are going to see this again today or Thursday. We are going to see vector spaces assigned to a matrix. But now, and we also have seen, the last theorem that we have seen was, if you have a square matrix, an n by n matrix, then if it has a left inverse, it will immediately be an invertible matrix. It will, so for a square matrix, having a left inverse is equal to having a right inverse, and that matrix being invertible. Or if you find for a square matrix, if you find the right inverse, it will immediately imply that your matrix is invertible. Remember the definition. Our first definition was a matrix A is invertible if and only if there is a matrix, which we denote by A to the negative one, A times A inverse is equal to inverse times A, which is equal to identity. But if you have a square matrix, if you can just find a left inverse, it will automatically be a right inverse, your matrix will be invertible. And that matrix being invertible is equivalent to saying that AX is equal to zero has only the trivial solution. Because if your matrix is invertible and you are looking at this equation, AX is equal to zero, you can multiply both sides of that equation A inverse. AX is equal to zero, A inverse times A times X is equal to A inverse times zero. So X must be zero. Oh, good. So this is what we have seen. And then, okay, finally, let me also mention this. So for us, a matrix A is invertible if and only if, when you see that matrix as a coefficient matrix for a homogeneous system of equations, such a system must have only the trivial solution. Furkan? Osman Furkan. Tamam. Evet. Now let us write another corollary. So the same conclusion for a matrix being invertible, we can make the same conclusion for non-homogeneous system of equations. Corollary. Corollary. For a square matrix, a square matrix A is invertible if and only if A X is equal to B has a unique solution. And this is also easy to see. If your matrix is invertible, if A inverse exists, then you can multiply this equation from the left with A inverse. A inverse times A, X is equal to A inverse B. A times A inverse times A is equal to identity. So X must be equal to A inverse times B. Unique solution. If this, such an equation has a unique solution, this is an n by n matrix. How do we solve such equations? We form the augmented matrix, A and then B. And then we apply elementary row operations. If this matrix has a unique solution, then you apply your elementary row operations, this A should transform to the identity matrix. Otherwise, you will have an inconsistent system, a row of zeros and a non-zero for non-zero entry coming from B, or row reduced echelon form of A must be identity. That will produce a unique solution. Tamam? Good. And this is what we have been saying all the time. And also, I told this many times. Okay, I told this many times, so let us also write this. We also have, so again, for a square matrix, A is invertible. A is invertible if and only if determinant of A is not equal to zero. And now you can convince yourselves to this result at least like this. So if A is invertible, then when you apply elementary row operations, so is this true or false? If A is invertible, I should be able to write it as a product of elementary matrices. Tekerleme. Şu köşe kış köşesi. If A is invertible, Ümmü Gülsüm artık gözler şey oldu, kaçmanın anlamı yok. If A is invertible, then A can be written as a product of elementary matrices. Yes. Yes. Yes. Because if A is invertible, when you apply elementary row operations, that matrix must be row equal to the anar çabuk initial matrix. Identity matrix.
Wrong again. Later again.
If A is invertible and if you apply elementary row operations, then your matrix should be row equivalent to the identity matrix. Tamam. Along the way you apply elementary row operations. Tamam. When you apply an elementary row operation, it is equivalent to multiplying your matrix from the left with an element corresponding elementary matrix. So A, ER times ER minus 1 dot dot dot. E2, E1 times A is equal to identity. Tamam. Pendin.
Ne sınavlar çekiyoruz bunu ya.
Tamam mı? Then each elementary matrix is anı. Every elementary matrix is blank. Fill in the blanks. Every elementary matrix is invertible. So if you are, and they are also elementary matrices. So if you have an invertible matrix, it must be written as a product of elementary matrices. Each elementary matrix has non-zero determinant. Tamam? And so it is determinant must be zero, non-zero. And also we have seen this for in cofactor expansions. You can expand the determinant with respect to a row or with respect to a column. This will tell you that determinant of A is equal to determinant of A transpose. You can save these results, but at least once we should write it here. And determinant of A times B is equal to determinant of A times determinant of B. Okay. Now you can use this whatever you want. Okay. Tamam mı? Belgin, do you remember adjoint matrix? Yes, good. Perfect answer. Bu kadar. Ümidim, konuşacak bir şey yoktu. Evet. How do you form the adjoint matrix? Ana.
I can read, but I cannot. Okay, such answers lead you to the dark side. I understand.
Okay, so by looking at cofactors corresponding to each entry, tamam? And what was the relation between determinant of, what is the relation between A and adjoint of A? A times adjoint of A is equal to determinant of A times identity. What type of a matrix is determinant of A times identity? Such matrices are? They are diagonal matrix or scalar matrix. Because on the diagonal you will always see determinant. Tamam? Okay. Now we are going to see an application of adjoint matrices in solving systems of equations. And it is called the Cramer's rule. Okay. So we are going to start with this. A will be a square matrix and we will assume that the system has a solution, has a unique solution. So this matrix, coefficient matrix will be inverted. Let A be a square matrix. Let A be a square matrix. And A X is equal to B, B A system of linear equations. So for any solution for this system, for any solution, so let me denote this again by X, for any solution, X, we have, okay. So X satisfies this equation, so AX is equal to B. Now I'm going to multiply both sides of this equation with adjoint of A, which I know but cannot explain. Okay. So adjoint of A times A times X is equal to adjoint of A times B. And what is adjoint of A times A? Determinant of A times identity. We always, so determinant of A is a scalar. We put the scalars on the left-hand side of the matrix. So this is how we define multiplication. These attitudes, again, will lead you to the dark side. Yes, Ayos, hiçbir zaman sağa koymadık scalar. Same bir şey de yani dark side bunu yapıyoruz. Evet. So determinant of A times X, identity being the identity of matrix multiplication, and this is adjoint of A times B. No. So let us stop here and look at this equation one more time. So we are assuming that we have a square matrix for the coefficient matrix. So let us assume that A is an n by n matrix. Oh. And then this will be an n by one matrix. And this is again an n by one matrix. Tamam. X, X is a column matrix, n by one. N by one. So let us denote this column matrix like this. X, X1, Xk, Xn. So these are our variables. A's, the entries of A representing the coefficient. Now, let us look at the kth row. So this is a constant. This is a constant. So you multiply each entry with determinant of A, a scalar. So, and don't forget, we are assuming that this X is a solution for our system. So what does this tell us? This should imply determinant of A times xk is equal to so this is an n by one matrix. Senin adın ne? Rabia, kaçıncı soruşun? Şimdi senin Çalıkuş romanındaki öğretmenin adı neydi? He? Ha. Bu yaprak dökümü değil miydi? Tamam abi, bu kargaşalıkla seni hafızama kaydettim.
Pek beğenmedin galiba.
Evet, so okay. So
şimdi içinden şey, derse bir kere katıldım, o da doğru mu değil mi belli değil.
Tamam. And by one matrix. Tamam mı? And we are looking at the kth entry. So here, this is an n by n matrix. And this is an n by one matrix. Tamam. I'm going to take the kth row. I'm going to take the kth row and put it on top of B. Tamam. So this is what I'm going to do. So B matrix B, these are the entries on the right hand side of our B1 right hand side of our equations. So it will be B1 A1 K plus B2 A2K plus BN AN K. And don't forget, when we form the joint matrix, we put the first, we take the first row, write the corresponding cofactors in the first column. Hatırladınız mı? Kerem? Tamam mı? Hatırladık mı? Osman Furkan? Nevşehirli Furkan? Hatırlamadık. Hatırladın mı dedim. Tamam.
Şimdi anlatamıyorum ya ben de.
Adjoint matrix. Hatırlayın. Yardımcı olayım. Hatırladınız mı? Baloncuk. Önce burada bir şeyden parçaladım ya. Tamam. Adjoint matrix. How do you form the adjoint matrix? You take A11. Tamam mı? The first row, first column entry. You delete the first row and the first column. You look at the determinant of the remaining matrix and multiply this with negative 1 to the 1 plus 1. Tamam. So it will be, it is the cofactor corresponding to first row first, it is the minor of first row first column entry. Tamam mı? And then you come to first row second column. Tamam. Negative 1 to the 1 plus 2. Delete the first row, second column. Calculate the determinant. You get a number. Write it in the first column, second row. As you move along a row, as you move along the first row, you write the corresponding cofactors in the first column. Hatırladınız mı? Hatta bir isim şey, Kerem dedi, niye böyle yapıyoruz diye. Ama şimdi o da hiç böyle adam sürekli bir şey diyor. Hangi bir örnek? Umarım Kerem orada önünde lineer bir şey vardır. Tamam. Kararlaşma. Tamam mı? Burayı hatırladık mı?
Neden öyle yapıyoruz dediğim şey de transformer
oldu. Evet. Çarpmada eşit dedi. Tamam. Okay. So we are going to, so let's call this as DK. So now this part is important. Note that DK is the determinant of the matrix obtained from A by replacing the kth column by B. So actually this Cramer's method, Cramer's rule tells you that so to find this solution, what you need to do is replace the kth column of your matrix. Replace that kth column with this column matrix. Calculate that determinant. This will be your dk. Xk will be that determinant over the determinant of A. So let me write this and then we are going to discuss this a little bit more. Okay. So XK, so the kth entry of sonra make-up'larda şey olmasın. K, sana alacağım değil mi? Evet. Hadi yani. Sana alacağım. Sen alacaksın işte onun yukarıdan doğru yapacağım. K, the kth entry of the solution vector can be calculated like this. Dk, this is the determinant of the matrix being obtained by this kth column of matrix A by the matrix B and then over determinant of A. Of course, this will all make sense when determinant of A is non-zero. Of course, if determinant of A is non-zero, it means A is invertible and AX times B must have a unique solution. And Cramer's rule tells you an alternative way to find this solution. Tamam. And remember how, so you can either calculate the determinant with respect to a row or with respect to a column. Tamam. So if you want to calculate the determinant with respect to a row, how do you calculate that determinant? You take that row, and then you consider each entry, tamam mı? Each entry, and you multiply each entry with the corresponding cofactor, tamam mı? A11, delete the first row, first column, write the determinant of that matrix with a sign. That is in your adjoint matrix. You can do this also by using columns. You can fix a column. You can fix a column of your matrix, tamam? So as you see here, column K is fixed, tamam? And you are looking at the cofactors corresponding to those columns, tamam? And then each time you multiply this with B1, those signs are included here because these cofactors, they come inside, tamam? So this A1K, for example, A1K is the cofactor that is, you take the first row, kth column. You delete the kth column, first row. Negative 1 to the 1 plus k. Now look at the determinant of the remaining n minus 1 by n minus 1 matrix. Tamam? Now this is the determinant of a matrix, looking at the kth column. And then you multiply each cofactor, not with the kth column entries of A, but with these numbers. Tamam. This will represent the determinant of a matrix So you are going to take out the kth column, replace it with your matrix B. Tamam mı? Peki. Tamam. Ne olmadı? Ne işledi arkadaşım? Peki. Örnek. Anı?
Anı.
Oğlum sen orada uyuyorsun değil mi? Çeneye de dayanıyor. There is nothing. Emir seni böyle dışladın fark ettin mi? Evet. Yani fark etmediysen biraz daha bakacağım. Example. Cramer's rule in action. Solve the system. Don't forget, this rule is applied when your coefficient matrix is invertible. So this is a way to find that unique solution. Solve the system. Of course, we are going to use the Cramer's rule. Solve the system. X plus Y minus Z is equal to 6. 3X minus 2Y plus Z is equal to minus 5. X plus 3y minus 2z is equal to 14. Ben de diyorum bu derste niye bir huzur var? Bizimki yok ya. Evet. Böyle bir Kalmberg Since var. Ben de since diye okuyorum. Ali Arda Karalar bu kim ya? Evet. Tamam. So let me also let us give you this A matrix A matrix X matrix. Let me write it again in that form. So you can rewrite the given equation in this form. A 3 by 3 matrix or coefficient matrix 1 1 negative 1 3 minus 2 1 1 3 negative 2. This is your matrix A and X. Our variables are x, y, z, x, y, z, and the column matrix is 6, negative 5, negative 5, 14. Tamam mı? This is our matrix A, A, x is equal to B. Tamam mı? What is, so, A, x, okay. Now, what is the determinant of A? Calculate the determinant of A. Calculate the determinant of A. O ne demek şimdi? Calculate the determinant of A. Bu hareket mi?
Sen daha da geçmeden.
Evet. Determinant of
İnsanların fiziksel özelliklerine dair bir Türkçe böyle.
What is the determinant of A?
X 12 mi? Yok.
O notunu sormadık. Ben de X 3 bulmuşum evde.
X'in dışı nasıl? Ahmet sen bu kafayla yandırıyorsun.
Aşıkkından başlar istersen Mısar Bey. Evet. Sayın Hörgün. Evet. Valla sen ne yapıyorsun ne işleriyle arkadaşım? Önünde kitap açmış, oradan bakarak bir şeyler yazmalar. Mat, ha. Determinant hesaplama kitabım var. La 20. dünya. Hesapla şuna. İki kişi aynı sayı bulsunu. Eksi 3. Ben de eksi 3 buldum. Yaman da eksi 3 buldu. Başka bu aynı tutan yok. Biri eksi 13 dedi, biri eksi 23. O sonra eksi 17 dedi. 17. Tamam. Bünyenin eksi 3 yazıyor. Bünyenin de dersin hiç alakası yok. Orada oturuyor. Birazdan ölür zaten. Eksi 3. Minus 3. Tamam. Kalkulayın. Okay. So. X1, X2, X3. So X. X is equal to. We are going to write the determinant of our original coefficient matrix here. And then to find the determinant, we are going to replace the first column with this one. 6 minus 5, 14, 1 minus 2, 3 minus 1, 1, 2. Evet, bu kaç? Arada cepte hesap mı gelirse? Ha. Ah canım, sebep oydu. Ne var? Madem bu kadar şeysin söyle, determinant kaç bunun? Emir? Emir şunun determinant kaç aldı midterm'den? Midterm'den kaç? Ha? Yüz oldum şimdi. O 34 aslında. Yanlışlık olmuş. Neyse ama düzeltiriz. Sen bir gelip uzun süre gelmeyen arkadaşım. Determinant kaç üstteki? 2. Bergin hadi söyle şunun determinantını. Bergin de yani şey hani memur evrak doldurur ya, yaz bitmez ha. Yani, Kerem onu var ya alnına yapıştırırım şimdi. Kaç oğlum, yerinde yapamayanın tartıda. Niye burada rezil olmak istiyorsun? Tamam, kaç buldun?
Ben bakıyorum, eksi 4.
Ya hadi biri bulsun. Ana kaç buldun? Kaç? Ha? Kaç? Oğlum sen sürekli kaç buluyorsun? Yaman kaç buldu?
Hadi ya.
Ben de eksi 3 bulmuşum. Eksi 3. Ümit Üstün kaç buldun? Ya ben eksi 3 bulmuşum. Ha?
Eksi 3 hocam.
Eksi 3 kim buldu onu? Determinant Merve işte ya. Ne varsa şu online grupta var diyecektim ama araya da biri karışmış. Minus 3. Over minus 3. So X is equal to 1. So again, 1. To find 1, again we are going to divide by negative 3. But we need to consider the determinant of this matrix. We will, this time we will keep the first column and then we are going to replace the second column 6 minus 5, 14 minus 1, 1 minus 2. And if I am not mistaken, this should be negative 9 over negative 3. And finally, Z is negative 3 here. And I'll pardon. I'll give a little bit of a check. So 1, 3, 1, 1, negative 2, 3. Now the third column will change 6, 5, minus 5, 14. And this is 6. Over negative 3. And now you shouldn't make any mistakes here. It is, since it is easy to check your answer. So x is equal to 1, y is equal to 3, z is equal to ne? Tabii burada hata yaparsınız. X is equal to 1, y is equal to 2, z is equal to negative 2. X plus y 4. At least the first equation is correct. Tamam. It is not wrong trivially. Tamam mıyız? Ana. Tamam. Evet. Kremis Ruh. Tamam. Hocam çok üstüme geliyorsunuz. Otobüste olmama rağmen katılıyorum. Katılıyorum. Katılıyorum derse. Çok üstüme geliyorsunuz. Otobüste. İnternet arkadaşımız zaten. Evet. Tamam. Next we are going to learn trace of a matrix. Hadi evet. Bunu da şuraya yazmıştım. Trace. Bu defterler de çok bereketli çıktı.
Doktora yaparken almıştım bu defterleri. Bir dolar. Ama bir doları bir dolar yazdım.
Evet. Tamam. Trace. So we understood this Cramer's rule. Next, we are going to learn trace of a matrix. Trace. We are going to define trace of a square matrix. The trace. The trace of an n by n matrix. And by n matrix A is defined as and along the way we are going to introduce our notation trace A. So you have a square matrix. So you have a main diagonal, you add up the entries on the main diagonal. A 1 plus A 2 plus A n. And so this operation on a matrix. So this is a map from square matrices to your field. Because don't forget, although I kept forgetting that we have matrices over a field. So entries are coming from a field. So this trace will be a scalar for us. So trace, you can think that trace is an operator from square matrices to your field. Tamam. And it will become very important. So there are two ways to see properties of this operator. So namely trace of A plus B is equal to trace of A plus trace of B and trace of C times A, C times A, C is a scalar, A is our matrix, so this is C times trace of A. Multiplying a matrix with a scalar means multiplying all the entries of that matrix, that scalar. In the next hour, we will see more, but not easy to see properties. And also, you should start thinking about that we see trace. You should start thinking about what about linear transformations. So then, for example, when you have a linear transformation, let's say we have a linear operator on a vector space V. So we can represent it with a matrix. We can define a trace. So what do you say to this statement? To define the trace of a linear transformation, find its matrix representation, and calculate the trace. Is this a meaningful statement? As professional students, you all know that the answer should be a little bit tricky. Evet, yes, olsa adam niye böyle dedi? So you should be careful there because a matrix representation depends on a choice of a basis. You may have a linear operator on a vector space, but that starts with choosing a basis. You choose a basis and represent that linear transformation. You obtain a matrix, calculate the trace. You choose another basis for your vector space, another matrix. What we are going to see next is the trace of a linear operator is independent of the choice of basis. It will always be the same. What are we going to use? We are going to use transition matrices. Transition. Okay, so let's give it. Evet, haydi. Katılıyor. Ay ben de korkarak geliyordum. Okay. Tamam. Okay. The next property that we are going to see about this trace operator is trace of A times B is equal to trace of B times A. Okay, this is what we have for the product of matrices. And the way that I'm going to show you these equalities, I'm going to calculate the traces for A times B and B times A. And we are going to observe that the trace for both products are the same. So let us start from the left hand side. Trace of A times B. So we are going to assume both A and B are n by n matrices. Evet. Gel. Trace of A times B. So if you assume both are n by n matrices, this will be equal to the sum of the entries on the main diagram. I from 1 to n, A times B, and we need to calculate Ri entry. So for this, I'm going to introduce another sigma notation. Sigma I from 1 to n. And then, so we have n entries on the main diagonal, k from 1 to n. And it will be A, I, K, and A, B, K, R. Now, if you look at this part, this is the entry for the diagonal entries. If you take I is equal to 1, if you take I is equal to 1, first row, first, so you take the first row and then you put it on the top of the first column. So for I is equal to 1, this will give you the first row, first column entry in the product matrix. Tamam? Anlaştık mı? Okay. Buraya kadar. Any questions? Tamam. Now let us look at the other trace. Trace of B times A. This is again we have I from 1 to N. I from 1 to N. This time B times A. And then consider the I entry. And then let us write it again. I from 1 to N and K from 1 to N, B, I, K and A, K, I. Now, actually if you look at these expansions, these sums, we are going to see that we are adding up the same numbers. So let us see, for example, if you take I is equal to 1, I'm going to just, so there are more place here, there's more space here. So let me look at this one. If you take I is equal to 1, for I is equal to 1, this is B, 1, 1. A 1 1 plus B I is equal to 1 1 2 A 2 1 A B 1 and A and 1. Tamam. So this is for I is equal to 1. And then you keep on adding up like this. So let me say plus here, add up terms. And then the final row, it will be when I is equal to N, B, N, 1, A, 1, N, B, N, 2, A, N, 2, B, I is equal to N, N, A, N, N. Actually, you are looking at the sum of these terms. And now you can take this as an exercise. When you expand this sum, you are going to see these terms again. So these two sums are the same. For example, if you take I is equal to 1 here, so let me, when you take I is equal to 1, this is, let me write it here. A 1 1 B 1 1 plus A I is equal to A 1 2 B 2 1 A I is equal to 1 and then K is N now B N 1 plus once and then A and K B A and 1 B 1 and A and 2 B 2 and plus A and B and and now when you look at these terms, for example, now if you look at this row, it is exactly here. Tamam. These are multiplication in a field. So multiplication is commutative. A, B and 2 is equal to A and 2. Tamam. First row, these are the same. Tamam. All these terms are exactly the same. So this, when you compare the terms that you add up, you will see that in both of these expressions, trace of AB and trace of BA, they are the same. Tamam?
A2 and omega.
I is equal to
hayır.
Hayır, tamam.
Yani tam exact olması da oralarda var hepsi. Yani A2N şeydi, ikinci satırda gerçek o zaman. Tamam. Anlaştık mı? Belki yanlış söyledim ama özü doğru. Tamam mıyız? Helen?
Good.
Anna?
Good.
So, this is one thing that we need to solve. Now, where are we going to use this expression? We are going to use this expression for this property for seeing that trace of a linear operator is independent of the choice of basis for a given vector space.
Theorem. Nasıl yazacağım? The trace the trace of a matrix linear operator does not depend on the choice of a basis.
Okay. So let me try to clarify what I wanted to say here. Let L. So again, let us work with finite dimensional vector spaces. So let us take an L, a linear operator on V. That is to say, we have a linear transformation from V to V. Tamam. Anlaştık. And B and C are two bases for our vector space. Tamam. Now we know what we mean by this notation. This is the matrix representation of our linear operator using the basis C. So how do you calculate this matrix? You choose basis C here and basis C here. You look at, so let's say that in vector, in basis C you have W1, W2, Wn. You look at the image of W1, write it as coordinates with respect to these basis elements and then put it in your first column. Do the same for W2, W3, Wn. You have an n by n matrix. Tamam. That is your matrix. And on the other hand, we have this matrix, this time on both sides. Remember, if I just put one basis. In this notation, it means we are using the same basis on both sides. Şimdi belki sen bilmiyorsundur. On both sides. Evet. Anlaştık mı? Bunları hatırladık mı? Hatırladık mı buraları? Sana bakıyorum. Aradım. Senden başka kimse yok. Hatırladık mı? Adam tamamen hülyalı düşüncelere dalmış. Hatırlamadık mı? So to represent a given linear transformation. To represent a given linear transformation by a matrix, you need to choose basis. Tamam. And then, so in general, so this is a linear operator, so we are working with the same vector space. If it is a linear transformation from a vector space V to another vector space W, I'm going to choose two bases, and then you look at the images of your basis elements. For the domain vector space, and then you look at it as image, for image vector space you have a basis, and then you write the coordinates in columns. The coordinates of the image of the first basis element in the first column. Belki. Tamam. Rabia. Tamam, anlaştık. And what was the relation between these two matrices? We have transition matrix. So remember, we have a transition matrix from B to C. So it is, so this is T and T inverse. Remember, this is the transition matrix taking the coordinates. So from B to C transition matrix. Tamam? Anlaştık mı? Anlaştık mı? Hatırladınız mı? Beni? Tamam, mükemmel. So now what we want to say here is trace of this matrix and trace of this matrix, they are the same. So it does not matter with respect to which basis you work, you will end up with the same number as the trace. Anlaştık mı? Ümmü Gülsüm? Tamam. So let us calculate the trace of this linear, this matrix. Tamam. So the trace of this matrix is equal to trace of T. The matrix representation of our linear operator using the basis B and T inverse. Although the matrix multiplication is not commutative, it is associative. Tamam. So I can see this as T times L of B times T times L of B times T inverse. Tamam. So we have T as our first matrix, and this is the other matrix. And I'm going to use this property. Trace of AD is equal to trace of BA. Tamam. So this trace on the right hand side is equal to trace of and B T inverse times T. This is identity, this being a transition matrix invertible. So this is trace of B. Anlaştık. So you can work with any basis you want for a linear operator on a given finite dimensional vector space. The trace will not change. It is independent of the basis that you choose. Anlaştık mı? Anıl. Tamam mı? Hocam. What if we use different basis on the domain and for domain to represent the L? Is this the answer to you?
Let me think. Yeah, but then you need to come up with four four different bases, and we did not define this transition matrix. Let me think about it, because we did not, we introduced this transition matrices for linear operators and using the same basis on both sides. And I understood the question. I don't have, I know the answer, but I cannot explain.
While I was studying, I actually extended the transition matrix to multiple different vectors.
Very good for you. Do you want to explain it here?
Yes.
Okay, tamam. Yani bir bakayım onu. Şimdi burada ders sırasında yaparsam sırtımdan atan terim adli hesabı olmaz. Bir daha vakti devirim. Düşünün. Tamam mıyız? Anlaştık mı adam? Yeniden sorayım da ne olur mu? Okay. Then, this is how we are going to define the trace of a linear operator. Trace of a linear operator is the trace of this matrix. Choose any basis for your vector space. The trace of your linear operator will be the trace of the corresponding matrix. Tamam mı? Tamam. Anlaştık mı burada tanımda? Trace of a linear operator is equal to trace of its matrix representation with respect to any choice of basis for the given vector space. Helin, Örkün, Örkün, Örkün. Gözleri belertti. Okay, now I will give you an exercise. Yes, good. Now, example, let V be a real vector space and L is a linear operator on V. Tamam. Can trace of A squared be negative? What is A squared? What error it to say? L squared, you apply L twice. Göz kısılınca daha iyi anlaşılıyor. Sana demiyorum Osman. Osman Fırkan zaten bir şeyler düşünüyor ama.
Bir yastığı koymuşsun kenara.
Evet. Anı soruyu anladık mı? Tamam. Can this happen? Hey, sence cevap yes mi oldu? Bunca yıllık öğrencilik hayatım. Ha? No, niye real dedim diye, değil mi? Kompleksliydim, kesin olurdu. Şimdi bir daha soruyorum. Sence bir yes mi oldu? Kardeş biraz önce no dedin, dalga geçtin. Ama sana da güven olmaz ki diyorsunuz. Ha?
No'yu artık biliyorum.
Şu an fikrini değiştirir misin? Hani öyle bir soru var ya, şu üç kapı var. Birinin arkasında son model bir araba var. Diğer iki kapı boş. Ben sunucuyum. Sen bir tane kapıyı seçiyorsun.
Ben arkasında ne olduğunu biliyorum. Sen bir kapıyı seçiyorsun. Tamam mı? Sonra ben arkası boş olan kapılardan birini açıyorum. Sana dönüp soruyorum. Kararını değiştirir misin? Değiştirirsen mi kazanma şansın daha çok? Durursan mı ilk tercihinden? İşte Anıl'ınki de öyle bir şeydi. Tamam, konuyu çarpıtmayalım. Tamam. Evet. Tamam. Tamam. The answer is yes. Elinir de hemen ben yes dedim ya. What is the trace of, so suppose this vector space is two dimensional. Tamam mı? What is the trace of the identity matrix?
Two.
One plus one. O birleşir. One. Tamam. If we can produce a linear operator whose matrix representation is negative identity, then its trace will be negative two. So let us look at this linear transformation, linear operator. R squared to R squared. This is where we produce our examples. Give me a linear operator for which when I apply twice, x comma y goes to negative x negative one. Evet. Ben yazmışım. So if this is your linear operator, if this is your linear operator, tamam. So L squared is defined like this. You go from R squared to R squared by applying L, and then you apply L one more time. You take x comma y, and then you send this to minus y comma x. Now, what does your operator do? It puts this one first, minus y, then minus x. Tamam.
Şey. If we use a complex vector space, we can achieve a similar result by multiplying.
Başka türlü sıçrar yok. Böyle dalga falan geçmiyor. Which is written in Wikipedia.
My question, can we use this in the operation?
This is also in complex. You can take this as complex vector space.
Can we use this in the transformation to define y? That is my
question. Ben seni nasıl tanımlayayım?
Define the imaginary unit.
Ya tamam şimdi şey, şunu anladık mı? Tamam Cahil hocam, çıkışa gel. Tamam mıyız burada? What is the matrix representation of L squared? So I'm not going, so let's say that we choose the standard basis here. Tamam. Let me say B. So it does not depend which basis you choose, but if you work with the standard basis, it is very easy to represent your matrices. So this is 1, 0, 0, 1. This is your basis. And with respect to this basis, your matrix is this one, and its trace is negative 2. Tamam, anlaştık. You can produce more examples. Like this. Tamam. Bu da tamam. Sonra nereye geçiyorum? Trace.
Anlaştık mı? Anlaştık. Ha?
Tamam. Now we are going to look at vector spaces assigned to a matrix. Tamam. Soru. Burada soru var mı? Subspaces associated with a matrix. We are going to see row space, then column space. Let us start with the row space. So basically row space means, so if you have an M by N matrix, not necessarily a square matrix, an M by N matrix, it has M rows and columns. So when you consider rows of this matrix, you will see n tuples. Tamam. So you may see them as vectors in F to the n. Tamam. Let's say that we are working with real matrices. So in the first row, you will see n numbers. So you may think that these are vectors from Rn. Tamam. So the row, so you have m rows. By row space, you mean the subspace of Rn spanned by the rows of the given matrix. Tamam. This is what we mean by the row space. So what you need to understand in general will be producing a basis for the row space and understanding the dimension of that subspace. So what you need to do is, you need to understand whether they are linearly independent or not. And the way that we are going to solve this issue is by applying elementary row operations. As you apply elementary row operations, you will see the dependency between those. So suppose you have five rows. As you apply elementary row operations, if you end up two rows of zeros, then your row space will be three dimensional. So this is what we mean by the öbür taraftan olacağım şey varmış. Okay. Tamam. Okay. Now let us start with the definition. Let A be an M by N matrix over a field F, then it is rows can be, so it is rows will be n tuples. Adım istediğini görüyorum. It is rows can be considered, these n tuples can be considered to be vectors as n. So for simplicity, you can think F, the field, as the field of real numbers. The subspace, the subspace
spent by these rows by these row vectors is called the row space or space of A, and its dimension is called the row rank or rank of A.
Tamam. Onun her türlü böyle gariplik varsa.
Tamam mıyız buraya kadar? Tamam. So, for future reference, we are going to define, so we have row rank. So, for a given matrix, an M by N matrix, we define the row rank of a matrix by the by the dimension of the subspace of Fn spanned by the rows of R matrix. So we are going to do the same for the columns of a given matrix. We are going to define the column rank similar, and they happen to be the same number. We are going to call that number as the rank of a matrix. And we will see that this is actually nothing but the rank that we define for linear transformations. Remember the rank nullity theorem. What was the rank? Dimension of the image. Tamam. Okay. So along the way, what we need to say is we are going to. So this column space, we are going to use this idea to solve such, for example, I can give you 5 vectors. And then I want you to find a basis, which is find a basis for the subspace spanned by those 5 vectors. What you are going to do is you are going to put those vectors as the rows of a matrix. Apply the anti-row operations, then you end up with echelon matrix, you will stop and then take those rows as a basis for the space spanned by those vectors. So what we need to say along the way is if you have 2 matrices which are row equivalent, then their row spaces are the same. Anlaştık mı? And if you have an echelon matrix, if you have an echelon matrix, what was the definition of an echelon? Negatif oluyor gibi J2'nin standart basisinde 90 derece linear function olarak yazarsak trace. Ne diyor bu ya? Ne zaman yazmış hocam? Evet Arda. Ne güzel bir şey yapıyoruz. Belki otursa Antalya yapıyormuş. Geliyor mu yoksa?
Geliyor.
Tamam, Belgin, bu arada sen düşündün. How did we define the echelon matrix? An echelon matrix. Bak en güzelini Belgin yapıyor. Biraz daha şey yapsan ya heyecandan düşüp bayılacak gibi böyle bir tavırlar. Kerem Efendi, bu cep telefonunun alnını yapıştıracağım birazdan. Evet. Ben öyle mi anlatıyorum Belgin? Emir?
Wien'in kelimeleridir. Sonra...
Kardeşim ben böyle mi anlatıyorum?
Ben de ondan korkuyorum. Okay.
A matrix is called an echelon matrix if the leading entry, the first non-zero entry of each row is one, and the leading entry of each row appears on the right-hand side of the preceding rows. So if so, the leading entry of the second row cannot be on the left-hand side of the leading entry of the first row, and we put all the rows of zeros at the bottom of our matrix. Now, if you have such a matrix, so if you have a, if you have an echelon matrix, and if you consider the rows of such a matrix, rows must be linearly independent. Just look at the leading entries, because in the leading entry one, and the so when you look at the column below it, it must be zero. So you cannot write the first row as a linear combination of the remaining rows. Done. So that will be the main idea. So before we proceed, let me write these remarks about row space. So two row equivalent matrices, A and B have the same row space. In particular, they are of the same row length, so when you, if you start with a matrix and apply the Mantel row operations, nothing changes in the row space. And what is the reason behind this fact is, so for example, if you start from A, apply elementary row operations and arrive at the matrix B, then it means B is equal to an invertible matrix P, P being the product of elementary matrices corresponding to those elementary row operations. Tamam. P times A. Now, if you look at this equation, if you write this matrix B here, and if you just write A as row 1, row 2, row 3, row n, then you are going to see that rows of B are linear combinations of the rows of A. If rows of B are linear combinations of rows of A, then row space of B is contained in the row space of A. Also, if this is the case, then you can also write A as Q times B. This will tell you that rows of A are linear combinations of rows of B. So row spaces are the same. So think about this. So this equation tells you that rows of B are linear combinations, of rows of A, and finally, when we arrive at an echelon matrix for this row space business, we will stop and then we will take the non-zero rows as a base. And the main reason will be this one. Non-zero rows, of
an echelon matrix, echelon matrix are linearly independent. Tamam. Anlaştık mı? Because these leading entries, so first, if it appears here, the second one will be on the right hand side, the third one. Even if you can apply this, this R definition for being linearly independent, C1 times the first row, plus C2 times the second row, plus C3 times the third row. Let's assume that in echelon form, we have three non-zero rows. C1 times the first row plus C2 times the second row plus C3 times the third row is equal to zero. Tamam. But when you look at the leading entry for the first row, the other entries are zero. So this will immediately tell you that C1 must be zero. Tamam. So the way that we are going to use this row spaces, I will give you a bunch of vectors to find a basis. Spanned by those vectors, we are going to put them as rows of a given matrix, apply elementary row operations, and then we will take the non-zero rows as a basis. Tamam? Anlaştık. But this will happen on Thursday. Then we will see column spaces, and although we have already talked about this, this when you take a homogeneous system of equations, AX is equal to zero. Solutions, they form a subspace. Tamam? Not true for non-homogeneous systems. Tamam? Şok. Tamam. That is all for today.